वदनं मधुरं नयनं मधुरं हसितं मधुरं
अधरं मधुरं वदनं मधुरं नयनं मधुरं हसितं मधुरं
अधरं मधुरं वदनं मधुरं नयनं मधुरं हसितं मधुरं
अधरं मधुरं वदनं मधुरं नयनं मधुरं हसितं मधुरं
हृदयं मधुरं गमनं मधुरं मधुराधिपतेरकुलं 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 मधुरं
वचनं मधुरं चरितं 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 मधुरं
वसनं मधुरं वलितं मधुरं
वसनं मधुरं वलितं मधुरं
चरितं मधुरं भ्रमितं मधुरं
चरितं मधुरं भ्रमितं मधुरं
मधुराधिपतेरकुलं मधुरं
मधुराधिपतेरकुलं मधुरं
मधुराधिपतेरकुलं मधुरं
मधुराधिपतेरकुलं
मधुराधिपतेरकुलं मधुरं
मधुराधिपतेरकुलं मधुरं मधुराधिपतेरकुलं मधुरं
राधे राधे कृष्णा, जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा, राधे राधे कृष्णा, जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा,
राधे राधे कृष्णा, जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा, राधे राधे कृष्णा, जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा,
राधे राधे कृष्णा, जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा, राधे राधे कृष्णा, जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा,
राधे राधे कृष्णा, जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा, राधे राधे कृष्णा, जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा।
गीतम मधुरम पीतम मधुरम,
गीतम मधुरम पीतम
मधुरम,
पीतम मधुरम, पीतम मधुरम,
भूतम मधुरम, सूतम मधुरम,
भूतम मधुरम, सूतम मधुरम,
भूतम मधुरम, सूतम मधुरम,
भूतम मधुरम, सूतम मधुरम,
रूपम मधुरम, तिलकम मधुरम, मधुराधिपते अखिलम मधुरम,
मधुराधिपते अखिलम मधुरम,
मधुराधिपते अखिलम मधुरम,
मधुराधिपते अखिलम मधुरम,
राधे राधे कृष्णा, जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा, राधे राधे कृष्णा, जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा,
राधे राधे कृष्णा, जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा, राधे राधे कृष्णा, जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा,
करणम मधुरम, करणम मधुरम,
करणम मधुरम, करणम मधुरम,
करणम मधुरम, करणम मधुरम,
करणम मधुरम, करणम मधुरम,
हरणम मधुरम, रमणम मधुरम,
हरणम मधुरम,
वमितं मधुरं शमितं मधुरं,
वमितं मधुरं शमितं मधुरं,
वमितं मधुरं शमितं मधुरं,
वमितं मधुरं शमितं मधुरं,
मधुराधिपतेरखिलं मधुरं,
मधुराधिपतेरखिलं मधुरम्।
माला मधुरा,
गुंजा मधुरा, माला मधुरा,
गुंजा मधुरा, माला मधुरा,
गुंजा मधुरा, माला मधुरा,
यमुना मधुरा बीची मधुरा,
यमुना मधुरा बीची मधुरा,
यमुना मधुरा बीची मधुरा,
यमुना मधुरा बीची मधुरा,
सलिलम मधुरम कमलम मधुरम,
सलिलम मधुरम कमलम मधुरम,
मधुराधिपते रखिलम मधुरम,
मधुराधिपते रखिलम मधुरम,
मधुराधिपते
रखिलं मधुरम्।
राधे राधे कृष्णा जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा राधे राधे कृष्णा जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा
राधे राधे कृष्णा जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा राधे राधे कृष्णा जय जय राधे राधे कृष्णा
ओमज्ञानशिबिरान् विद्या ज्ञानाञ्जलिशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः नमः ॐ विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिन्निति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्णा हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। इन दिस सेशन वील बी हियरिंग फ्रॉम द 12th चैप्टर ऑफ द 10th कैंटो ऑफ श्रीमद्भागवतम। This chapter is entitled The Killing of the Demon Aghasura. The opening verse of this chapter is spoken by Shukadev Goswami. He is narrating the pastimes of Krishna to Parikshit Maharaj. Sri Shuka Vacha Kvachid Vanashaya Mano Dadhat Prajat प्रातः समुत्थाय वयस्य वत्सपान प्रबोधयन श्रृंग रवेण चारुणा विनिर्गतो वत्स पुरस्सरो हरिः। The meaning of this verse is Shukadev Goswami is continuing to speak. He said, O king, one day Krishna decided to take his breakfast as a picnic in the forest. Having risen early in the morning, he blew his bugle made of horn and woke all the cowherd boys and calves with its beautiful sound. Then Krishna and the boys, keeping their respective groups of calves before them, proceeded from Rajabhumi to the forest. At that time, hundreds and thousands of cowherd boys came out of their respective homes in Rajabhumi and joined Krishna, keeping before them their hundreds and thousands of groups of calves. The number of cowherd boys is hundreds and thousands, difficult to count, big number, very big number. And each cowherd boy was having before him hundreds and thousands of groups of calves. So this is Krishna's opulence. The boys were very beautiful and they were equipped with lunch bags, bugles, flutes and sticks for controlling the calves. Along with the cowherd boys and their own groups of calves, Krishna came out with an unlimited number of calves assembled. Then all the boys began to sport in the forest in a greatly playful spirit. Now Krishna also brought calves, but Krishna's calves were of unlimited number, asankhyataha. This is a description by Shukadeva Goswami. That means it was not of the order of hundreds, thousands, lakhs, crores, billions, trillions, no. Srila Prabhupada explains, it was actually unlimited. Nobody could count. Although all these boys were already decorated by their mothers with ornaments of kacha, gunja, pearls and gold, when they went into the forest, they further decorated themselves with fruits, green leaves, bunches of flowers, peacock feathers, and soft minerals. The natural wealth available in the forest, beautiful, varied colored dyes of soft minerals, peacock feathers and bunches of flowers, different flowers, forest flowers, and green leaves of different trees, different shapes, different shades of green, and fruits. With all these things, the boys decorated themselves even more. Then all the cowherd boys, they are in a playful spirit. So they used to steal another's lunch bags. They were all carrying lunch bags. So they used to steal. When a boy came to understand that his bag had been taken away, the other boys would throw it farther away to a more distant place. And those standing there would throw it still farther. When the proprietor of the bag became disappointed, the other boys would laugh and the proprietor would cry. And then the bag would be returned. Just for fun, they were just doing this. But sometimes some boy would become really unhappy that his bag is completely disappeared. Where is it gone? He doesn't know. So when he begins to cry, others would actually somehow return it to him. Sometimes Krishna would go to somewhat distant place to see the beauty of the forest. Krishna is appreciating the beauty of the forest. He would go to a distant place. Then all the other boys would run to accompany him, each one saying, "I shall be the first to run and touch Krishna." Then someone else would say, "I shall touch Krishna first." In this way, they enjoyed life by repeatedly touching Krishna. Now, hear carefully how the boys were actually engaged in sporting. And Shukadev Goswami will give us a lesson at the end of this description of about 6 verses. All the boys would be differently engaged. Some boys blew their flutes, others blew their bugles made of horn, some imitated the buzzing of the bumblebees, others imitated the voice of the cuckoo, some boys imitated flying birds by running after the bird's shadows on the ground, some imitated the beautiful movements and attractive postures of the swans, some sat down with the ducks sitting silently, and others imitated the dancing of the peacocks. Some boys attracted young monkeys in the trees. Some jumped into the trees, imitating the monkeys. Some made faces as the monkeys were accustomed to do. And others jumped from one branch to another. Some boys went to the waterfalls and crossed over the river, jumping with the frogs. And when they saw their own reflections on the water, they would laugh. They would also condemn the sounds of their own echoes. This is the description by Shukadev Goswami to Parikshit Maharaj and all the saintly persons who are sitting very seriously and hearing about Krishna. And what are they hearing now? Some boys playing, some playful activities. What has that got to do with spiritual life? So Shukadev Goswami, who's describing very seriously, he's now telling, "Itham satam brahma sukhanubhutya dasyam gatanam paradaivatena mayashritanam naradarakena sakam vijagruh krita punya punja." Here is the most important verse that says, in this way, itham, all the cowherd boys used to play with Krishna. Now, who is this Krishna? Krishna is the source of the Brahman effulgence for jnanis desiring to merge into that effulgence. The jnanis, those who follow the jnana marga, they are, after severe austerities for millions of lives, they are able to realize the absolute truth as the impersonal Brahman effulgence, and they desire to merge into that Brahman effulgence. And what is that Brahman effulgence? It is the Brahman effulgence is the bodily effulgence of Krishna. Krishna is the source of the Brahman effulgence. Then Shukadeva Goswami says, this Krishna is also the supreme personality of Godhead for devotees who have accepted eternal servitorship. Dasyam gatanam paradaivatena. Krishna is the transcendental personality of Godhead for devotees who have accepted to be his eternal servant. And for ordinary persons, naradarakena, for ordinary persons, Krishna is but another ordinary child. Mayashritanam naradarakena, those who are under the influence of the illusory energy, most people in this world, even when Krishna appeared, they were under the influence of the illusory energy. When they look at Krishna, they think he is another covered boy, another ordinary child. But the most important point here is, Shukadeva Goswami is telling, Sakam Vijakru, the covered boys, they were able to associate with Krishna in this way, playing with him, after having accumulated the results of pious activities for many, 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 many lives. How can anyone explain their great fortune? Sakam Vijakru Prita Punya Punja. Punya Punja. They have accumulated Punya after many, 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 many heaps of pious activities. So, don't think that these boys are just playing like small children and wasting their time. No. What happens in the material world, the playful spirit among children, is actually a poor imitation or a perverted reflection of what actually goes on in the spiritual world. What actually goes on in the spiritual world? In the spiritual world, the devotees enjoy with Krishna on the Brahman platform. In the material world, the children or the young boys or the adults or the old men, all of them are trying to enjoy on the material platform. What's the difference? On the Brahman platform, there is pure transcendental bliss, and that is eternal without any reactions. On the material platform, there is only an illusory happiness, if at all there is some happiness, and it is temporary, it is full of reactions, and it is actually filled with miseries. So totally opposite. Enjoyment on the material platform and enjoyment on the Brahman platform. These boys, Krishna's covered boyfriends, are enjoying with Krishna on the Brahman platform. And their enjoyment is eternal. And they are full of transcendental bliss which Krishna shares with his devotees. Krishna is anandamayo abhyasat. This is the description of Krishna in the Vedanta Sutra. He is full of ananda, unlimited transcendental bliss. And what does Krishna do with that transcendental bliss? He shares it with his devotees who are constantly engaged in serving him. So the devotees, in serving Krishna, they enjoy transcendental bliss same as Krishna, equally with Krishna. Of course, nobody can enjoy as much as Krishna because Krishna is unlimited. But there is unlimited transcendental bliss available for each and every devotee who serves Krishna on the Brahman platform, on the spiritual platform, in pure devotional service. So, Shukadeva Goswami further explains, yogis may undergo severe austerities and penances for many, many births by practicing yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, none of which are easily performed. Ashtanga yoga is a very, very difficult yoga system. In fact, other than bhakti yoga, all other yoga systems are very, very difficult. Yet, in due course of time, when these yogis attain the perfection of controlling the mind, why do they do this? Yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, for controlling the mind. Then if they attain perfection after many, many lifetimes of difficult practice, they will still be unable to taste even a particle of dust from the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. They cannot taste that. That which the cowherd boys are enjoying unlimitedly, eternally. What then can we describe about the great fortune of the inhabitants of Vrajabhumi, Vrindavan, with whom the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, personally lived and who saw the Lord every day face to face? Who can describe? Who can understand? Then, thereafter, there appeared a great demon named Aghasura, whose death was being awaited even by the demigods. If you remember the beginning of this 10th canto, it was described, Mother Earth was burdened by so many demons who posed themselves as kings, but were actually demons, demoniac natured persons. So the demigods were harassed by these demons. So they were awaiting, when are these demons going to get killed? When are they going to die? When are they going to perish? So the demigods, they drank nectar every day, amrita. But still, nectar means they won't die untimely death. But still, they feared this great demon and awaited his death. This demon could not tolerate the transcendental pleasure being enjoyed in the forest by the cowherd boys. Unlike the devatas, the cowherd boyfriends of Krishna are not at all afraid of any demons. They're going into the forest. Prior to this, other demons have come to kill Krishna and Balaram, but Krishna has killed each one of them. So they are not at all afraid. They're not afraid of any demons. They are completely carefree. Whereas the demigods, in spite of performing so many yajnas and drinking nectar every day, still, they are afraid of these demons. They are waiting. When is this demon, or this demon, that demon, some other demon going to be killed? Aghasura had been sent by Kamsa, and he was the younger brother of Putana and Bakasura. Therefore, when he came and saw Krishna at the head of all the cowherd boys, he thought, this Krishna has killed my sister Putana and he's killed my brother Bakasura. So before this Aghasura came, already Putana had come, and Krishna was just an infant, few days old, on the lap of Mother Yashoda. And Bakasura had appeared, had come. Just in the previous chapter, we heard about Bakasura being killed by Krishna. So both the sister and brother Putana and Bakasura, the sister and brother of Aghasura, had been killed by Krishna. So Aghasura was very, very angry against Krishna. I am going to take revenge. So in order to please them both, Aghasura decided, I shall kill this Krishna along with his assistants, the other cowherd boys. And after deciding in this way, that crooked Agasura assumed the form of a huge python. These demons, they have this yoga siddhi, that they can change their form, and by expanding their size of the body, they can assume a body of gigantic proportions, huge proportions. So this Agasura, he assumed a form of a huge python. Python is typically a large snake which will simply swallow up somebody, and the swallowed person will be the animal or the human being will be inside the python's body for many, many, many days, weeks, months even. And the python will just lie down there, and slowly it will digest the flesh and then discard the remnants. So these pythons are very dangerous, though they appear to be like some you can't make out a python very easily, except when somebody who's experienced may guess here is a python waiting to swallow somebody who walks into it unknowingly. So having assumed this form of a python, this Agasura, he had become as big as a huge mountain, and he was as long as 8 miles. 8 miles is about 12.5 kilometers. 12.5 kilometers long. So who can guess it is some creature? They think it's some kind of mountain. Having assumed the wonderful python's body, he spread his mouth like a big cave in the mountain. Mouth of Agasura appeared like a cave in the mountain. And he lay down on the road, and the Kachcha road on which they traversed through the forest travelers. And he was expecting to swallow Krishna and his associates, the cowherd boys, thinking that they would playfully, while walking along the forest path, they would all simply enter without realizing that here is a demon who is waiting to kill them. Upon seeing the demon's wonderful form, which resembled a great python, the boys thought that it must be some beautiful scenic spot of Vrindavan. They are in a playful mood, and they are in the forest, and they are all together, and they have come for grazing the calves, but they are also simultaneously playing among themselves with Krishna. So they thought this is a beautiful spot. They imagined it to be similar to the mouth of a great python. They knew it looks like a python. They thought this scenic spot resembles a python. They never thought it is actually a python. In other words, the boys, unafraid, thought it was a statue made in the shape of a great python for the enjoyment of their pastimes. Throughout Vrindavan forest, actually, it was actually made beautiful by Yogamaya for the enjoyment of the cowherd boys and Krishna. This is Yogamaya's arrangement. That's a fact. But this was not a beautiful scenic spot. It's actually a demon in the shape of a python. Then the boy said, "Has this living creature come to swallow us? If he does so, he'll immediately be killed like Bakasura without delay. Krishna will kill them. If it is actually a living creature, we don't have to worry." So thus they looked at the beautiful face of Krishna, the enemy of Bakasura. They remembered Krishna had killed Bakasura, huge duck that Bakasura had appeared in the form of a huge duck. But Krishna simply pulled apart Bakasura's beaks and slit his whole body and killed him. So they were laughing loudly, clapping their hands. They entered the mouth of the python. Now Krishna, who is situated as Antaryami, the super soul in the core of everyone's heart, heard the boys talking among themselves about the artificial python. Unknown to them, who was this python or this artificial python? It is actually the demon Aghasura. He had assumed the form of a python. Krishna, knowing this, wanted to forbid his associates to enter the demon's mouth. Krishna wanted to stop these boys from entering. As Krishna was considering how to stop them, the coward boys had already entered the mouth of the demon. They were ahead, the coward boys, so they had already entered. Krishna was behind. He was thinking to stop them, already they have entered. The demon did not swallow them because he was thinking that this Krishna who has killed my sister and my brother, I am waiting for Krishna to enter my mouth. Then I will kill Krishna and all the covered boys. This was the plan made by Aghasura. Now Krishna is thinking, what can be done? How could the killing of the demon and saving of the devotees both be performed simultaneously? So Krishna was thinking how to accomplish that. Actually, Krishna is unlimitedly potent. He has got unlimited power. So he decided to wait for an intelligent means by which he could simultaneously save the boys and kill the demon. Thinking like that, Krishna made a plan and he entered the mouth of Aghasura. Krishna entered. Aghasura was just waiting. When Krishna entered the mouth of Aghasura, the demigods hidden behind the clouds exclaimed, "Alas, alas! Krishna has also entered along with the coward boys." The demigods were very afraid. What's going to happen now? But the friends of Aghasura, like Kamsa and other demons, they were very, very happy. Now Krishna is going to get killed along with all the other coward boys. When the invincible Supreme Personality of Godhead Krishna heard the demigods crying, "Alas, alas," from behind the clouds, what did Krishna do? Krishna immediately began to enlarge himself within the demon's throat. And just to save himself and the coward boys, he actually enlarged more and more and more. And because Krishna increased his size, the demon also started increasing his own bodily size. But he could not excel Krishna. Krishna is the Supreme Lord. So the demon has some mystic power by which he can expand himself, but there's a limit to how much he can expand. Krishna can unlimitedly expand himself, unlimitedly. So this difference always exists between Krishna and everyone else. Others, if they get some yoga siddhi of becoming big, there's a limit to how much they can become big. There's always a limit. Relatively, they can grow big. But Krishna, when he decides to become big, he can become unlimitedly big. So, we are always limited. Krishna is always unlimited. This difference eternally exists between Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and everyone else. So, Krishna, he expanded more and more and more. At a certain point, what happened? The demon's breathing stopped because he became suffocated by Krishna blocking his passage, air passage. And Krishna became very, 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 very big. And the demon could not expand anymore. Then the demon suffocated, his eyes rolled here and there, and popped out, and the demon's life air came out through a hole in the top of the demon's head. When the demon's life air had passed away through that hole in the top of the head, Krishna glanced over the dead calves and cowherd boys and brought them back to life. Because inside the Agasura's body, there was all kinds of poisonous fumes. It was meant to kill the prey, the python does that, like that. So, but Krishna glanced at the dead calves and cowherd boys and immediately brought them back to life. Then that Krishna came out of the demon's mouth along with all the cowherd boys and the calves. From the gigantic body of this demon in the shape of a python, a glaring effulgence came out, the soul of Agasura, illuminating all directions, and stayed individually in the sky until Krishna came out of the corpse's body. Body of that corpse, dead body anymore. So the soul came out and waiting. Then as the demigods looked on, they're watching what's happening. The effulgence entered into Krishna's body, that spirit. So Krishna awarded first Sayujya Mukti to this demon Agasura. And later on, this demon, because of association with Krishna, he got Sarupya Mukti. He got the same form as Krishna and went back to Krishna Loka. Thereafter, everyone being pleased, the demigods began to shower flowers, and the celestial dancing girls, the Apsaras, began to dance, the Gandharvas began to sing, and in this way, they all offered wonderful prayers to Krishna. And both in the heaven and on the earth, everyone began to perform their duties, glorifying Lord Krishna. So when Brahma heard this festival going on, he began to wonder, who is this Krishna? Is he really capable of killing such a demon, small cowherd boy? So the mystery behind who Krishna is, that will be explained in the next chapter by Shukadev Goswami. I'll stop here. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.